mode for a hillbilly concert.
Hey, I never know how to start these things. Hi just seems so terse and impersonal. I always liked how Johnny Cash started his performances. He goes back to his first performance, you know, the first time he was performing in front of an audience. He got up there and realized he didn't know what to say, so he just said, "Hello, I'm Johnny Cash," and then that became his hallmark. I've always liked that. It's very simple, direct, and to the point. I've got to come up with my own hallmark greeting. I'll get my creative team working on that. Now, speaking of creative team, I'm here with Brad. Say hi, Brad.
Hi, how are you?
If you're new to the show, Brad is our shape-shifting vision casting leader. And for the last few weeks, he's been pregnant with a name for the show. Unfortunately, we have some bad news. It turns out he wasn't really pregnant. It was a false alarm. Tell him what it was, Brad.
A slight disorder of the stomach. Might be an undigested bit of beef. A piece of cheese. A fragment of an underdone potato.
That's a shame. Well, maybe he can get pregnant with a snappy new greeting to start the show. I don't know how that works, and frankly, I'm afraid to ask. Say, try to guess the TV theme music from the intro. Guess it correctly, and you'll win a prize. Tell them what they'll win, Brad.
Have you ever wanted to lick your cat? Now you can, without the fur balls. Introducing Licky Brush.
If you missed the answer for the Bill Johnson the Lying Apostle video, here it is. So today we're going to be talking about criticism. I get criticized a lot for being critical, so we're going to break it down and see if we can't come to some kind of understanding on the subject. And to help us, we have Greg Groeschel of Life Church. Now, this sermon was uploaded a couple of years ago during their Relationship Vampire series.
You'll know that I am called the Count.
Calm down, Brad.
Sometimes I get carried away.
So without further ado, here we go.
Hey, it's great to have you with us today at all of our Life Churches and our Open Network Churches. We're in a message series called Relational Vampires. What do vampires do? They suck your blood. We're talking about in this message series, how do we love people who suck the life out of us? How many of you have somebody in your life that can be a little bit difficult at times?
Oh, pick me! Oh, I know, me!
I can be a bit difficult at times. More than a bit difficult, if you want to know the truth. I know that's hard for many of you to believe, but...
Last week we talked about those who are controlling us.
You didn't criticize controlling people, did you?
Today, I want to deal with something that all of us will have to face at one point or another. All of us will face critical people, those who can be overly critical. In fact, how many of you would say that you have someone in your life that has the spiritual gift of fault finding?
Oh, pick me! Oh, I know, me!
Like, I'm just curious, has anybody ever heard somebody ever criticize our church before? Has that ever happened? Raise your hand up.
Oh, pick me! Oh, I know, me!
Oh, man, you hurt my feelings. I had no idea. No. I mean, it's just a part of it, right? Our church can be a very easy target. You know, it's the video church. Everybody knows that God can't move through video.
Well, that's not really the criticism that people levy against a video church. Now, what he just said there is what we call in logic a red herring. You make up your opponent's argument or you misrepresent it because you don't want to deal with the argument as presented. I guess that's one way to deal with criticism. Just change it into something you can deal with. Turn that frown upside down. Nobody argues against this type of church by saying that God can't move in this type of church. Nobody who knows God and His Word says that anyway. What they say is this is not biblical. Now, I'm not making an argument for or against this kind of church. I'm just saying let's do try to be honest in our response to criticism.
It's too big. It's too big, even though people are going to hell.
Again, this is a red herring. Just minimize the argument. Make a caricature of it. Brush it off. It's not legitimate. Greg seems to think here in this sermon that all criticism is illegitimate. But there is a biblical argument that a church can be too big. It's a legitimate argument. I'm not saying I agree with it, but at the same time, I don't just brush it off.
The preacher's too demanding. He's always asking us, serve. Like Jesus, he's always asking us to serve.
His first point he's about to get to is to ignore your criticisms. But he's not ignoring his criticisms here. He's responding to them. But it's a one-sided response. See, he won't respond to the critics. Instead, he responds to the public without offering the critics a chance to respond. They just say I'm too demanding. They don't make an argument for it. They just hurl it at me. Well, Jesus asked us to serve, so nah, I'm right. He's responding to his criticism here. He's about to tell his congregation not to respond to their criticism in just a minute. He's also going to make the case that Jesus didn't respond to his critics, but he did. And when he did, he responded to them personally, face to face. But we'll get to that.
The preacher doesn't talk enough about insert your favorite subject.
Jesus.
He talks way too much about insert your least favorite subject.
Greg Groeschel. Nothing personal, but when it comes to a sermon, I really prefer to hear more about Jesus than the preacher. It's a quirk of mine.
He uses the wrong version of the Bible. Too focused on the unchurched, the teaching is too shallow. His clothes are too trendy, too expensive, or too tight, depending on the outfit.
Now again, he's responding to his own criticism here, and he's just moments away from instructing us not to respond to ours. That's a little hypocritical, wouldn't you say?
In other words, if you are alive, you're going to deal with criticism. And especially if you're a follower of Jesus, you're going to be different from this world. Your values are going to be different, and you will be criticized. You will be persecuted. If you're following Jesus, we need to learn how do we deal with criticism. Some of you, this is wrecking relationships. Your mom or dad's critical all the time. Your grandma is critical. In your marriage, you're critical. Your boss is critical. How do we love as Jesus followers? How do we respond to people with a critical spirit?
Now, what's a critical spirit? That's not a criticism. It's a question. It's a legitimate question. Sometimes people confuse the two. A lot of times I'm just asking questions and people are like, criticizing me for asking questions. Like I just asked you a question.
How do we respond to critical people? Number one, often you don't respond. Oftentimes you don't respond. Just because someone criticizes you does not obligate you to respond. And this can be incredibly freeing. In fact, this was Jesus's kind of line of offense. In fact, 1 Peter 2:23 says this about Jesus. Peter says, when they hurled insults at Jesus, what kind of insults would they say about Jesus? They said he was a friend of sinners, and this was not a compliment. They said he was a drunk. They said he ate too much. They said he partied really hard. They said he was a lunatic, that he was a false god, he was a heretic, and on and on and on and on and on. If they criticize Jesus, who is perfect, they will criticize you. When they hurled insults at him, what did Jesus do? Peter said, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. Notice, he did not retaliate. He did not defend himself. He did not complain. He simply entrusted himself to his Father in heaven.
So this is in the context of submitting to government authorities. This is referring to when Jesus was put on trial and he did not at that point answer his critics. But he did answer his critics during his ministry. And he did so in public, in the presence of those criticizing him. In Mark 2:6, his critics were criticizing him. Actually, they were just thinking it, but Jesus knew what they were thinking. That they were thinking, this guy's a blasphemer for claiming to be able to forgive sins. Did Jesus brush them off? Be gone, haters! No, he answered them and then demonstrated that he is in fact able to forgive sins. Now, in that same chapter, he is criticized for eating with sinners. Did he brush them off? No, he responded in verse 17. It is not the healthy who need a physician, but the sick. Now, in the very next verse, verse 18, they criticize him for not making his disciples fast, and he answers that criticism. Then in verse 19, the very next verse after that, they criticize him because his disciples picked grain to eat on the Sabbath, and he answered them. The next chapter, chapter 3, they criticize him for healing on the Sabbath, and he answers them. That same chapter, verse 20, he is criticized by members of his own family for being crazy. And then the Jewish leaders chime in and accuse him of being possessed by a devil. Jesus responded with a rather lengthy response. He told some parables. He used it as an opportunity to teach. Now, this is just two chapters in one of the Gospels. The four Gospels are littered with accounts of Jesus responding to criticism. However, as it was prophesied, when he was brought before the rulers and kings, he did not open his mouth. So Peter, too, is telling us that when we are brought before rulers and kings, that we should not try to defend ourselves. But we ought always to defend the truth, as Peter said in the same letter, 1 Peter 3:15, to always be ready to give an answer for the hope that is in you.
How do you respond to critical people? Sometimes you don't. Be free. Just because they have access to you doesn't mean that that demands a response from you. In fact, I love what Proverbs 19:11 says. Scripture says that a person's wisdom yields patience. It's to one's glory to do what? Let's all say this aloud. It's to one's glory to overlook an offense. To overlook an offense. What does that mean?
It means to forgive people when they have sinned against you, as in when they have criticized you unjustly, wrongly. But not all criticism is wrong or unjust. Peter goes on to say in the passage we just looked at that if you are in sin, don't think this is persecution in the sense that Jesus was talking about, or Peter, or Solomon, who wrote this proverb. You know, if you're being criticized because you're in sin, not to say, oh, they're persecuting me for righteousness' sake. Greg seems to be saying that all criticism is wrong. But, you know, Solomon worshipped pagan idols. And in 1 Kings 11:9 through 13, God had some pretty sharp criticism for him.
Overlooking an offense is not the same thing as pretending it didn't happen. It's not the same thing. What it means is, in fact, the word overlook comes from a couple of Hebrew words that it means to pass over, to get over it. What to overlook an offense.
Hey, pass over. What should that make you think of, Christian? God passed over our offenses and settled on his son who bore our offenses. The book of Proverbs really is about Jesus, the wisdom of God, the wise son.
It's a form of forgiveness, but it's not forgiving something that's past tense. It's choosing to forgive in real time. In other words, I know that that's really not fair, and I know that I could get angry, and I know that I could fight back, and I know that I could retaliate, and I know that I could become defensive, and I know I could let that become make my heart bitter, but I'm choosing in the moment to get above that and to overlook it and to let it go in real time. It's to man's glory to rise above an offense.
Oh yeah, that's so much better than God passing over our offenses and pouring his wrath out on his son. The wise son of the book of Proverbs who did not deserve it in our place. We are the fools in the book of Proverbs. Jesus is the wise son. It's not really life advice, unless you're a moralist, which I think Greg is.
To forgive in real time. I'm not going to wait for 3 months to be upset and be bitter and get over this later on. I'm choosing right now because I'm called by God, because I've got a higher purpose. I understand your heart may not, you may not know the context. I'm rising above this. This is something that Amy and I did recently.
We'll fast forward through Greg's life story. It's my least favorite subject. Yeah, he could have gone to an example of Jesus, my favorite subject, perhaps him forgiving those who were crucifying. But, well, you know, Greg's the preacher.
We experienced what was a very, very, very real, in the moment, deep and significant hurt. And there was a big part of me that wanted to get down in it. I wanted to defend. I wanted to strike back. I wanted to let somebody know this isn't fair, this isn't right. And everything in me wanted to do that, to defend. But sometimes you just let the Spirit of God lift you above it. You choose in real time. I can let that in my heart. But God's got something better for me. I'm not going to let something lower take me off of a higher call. I don't know who I'm speaking to right now. But every now and then when you're so lifted by the calling of God, you just choose to overlook, to pick up, to get spiritual air above this thing in real time. That could hurt me. I could want to fight back. But we're getting above this. We're moving beyond it.
How do you respond to critical people? Sometimes you don't respond. The second thing is sometimes you respond carefully.
I agree. Responses should be framed in a careful manner. The apostles who were given authority to by Jesus to teach us all the things he commanded us actually commanded this in several passages. Now, Greg goes to the Old Testament account of Gideon to demonstrate this. I'm not sure why. I don't know why he didn't use some of the New Testament passages that directly address this. But anyway, since we can agree that this is a valid point, we'll move on to the next one.
In other words, at some point, you're going to do something and someone's going to criticize you. Why in the world are you going back to school? Well, you're going to go serve in full-time ministry? That's stupid. You ought to be in business. Why do you serve all those hours at church? I mean, why do you go up there on Wednesday night and do that? Well, wait a minute. You're going to tell me that you're going to be a stay-at-home mom when you've got all that talent? Or the other side, you mean tell me you're going to go to work when you should be a stay-at-home mom? Or whatever it is, can't win, right, ladies? And so what are you going to do when someone does that? Sometimes you just offer context.
That's why he didn't go to a New Testament doctrinal statement. The New Testament doesn't have anything to say about this category of criticism. It's all about criticism for righteousness' sake. But people don't want to hear that. They don't want to know how to handle criticism for righteousness' sake. They want to know how to handle criticism regarding all the little minutiae of their lives. They want a list. Give me a list of things to do. But the Bible doesn't really have anything to offer in this matter, how to handle criticism in a general sense. But, you know, you can take an Old Testament story, like the story of Gideon, and kind of make it about that, and people are happy. Yeah, and then they're like, oh, yeah, it's in the Bible, after all.
You explain and give an explanation, and sometimes that will make sense to someone. And just like in Gideon's place when they heard the answer, their anger subsided. What happens? Your friend unleashes on you with harsh criticism. Your coworker picks you apart. You didn't do this, you didn't do that, you didn't do this. Your parents, they're riding you and riding you and riding you and riding you. What do? You wait before you respond. You wait before you respond. Because when emotions are high, wisdom is low.
This is all pretty good advice. I'm not saying it isn't. But it isn't really what the Bible is teaching. Now, some of us come to church to hear what God has said. This, what he's saying here, you can hear it any number of secular motivational conferences.
I think I'm preaching, Pastor Chris, a little better than people are responding.
Harumph, 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 harumph. I didn't get a harumph out of that guy.
I'm going to fast forward to where this preacher actually preaches something God said.
But when emotions are high, you're not being led by the Spirit, you're being driven by emotions. What we're going to do is we want to wait to respond. In other words, when you type it out, don't hit send. Right? Just wait a little while. We're not going to be driven by emotions. We're going to be led by the Spirit. And then when someone's incredibly critical, I want to encourage you to remember that oftentimes the criticism really isn't about you. Oftentimes the criticism is born out of a hurt in their own life. In fact, I found that most angry people are actually hurting people. That there's some wound, and sometimes it's something that they don't like about themselves that manifests itself in a critical spirit about someone else. In fact, I found that those who are very critical of me are actually often dealing with some inconsistency in their own life.
Whoa, wait a minute. What did he just say?
In fact, I've found that those who are very critical of me are actually often dealing with some inconsistency in their own life.
Right. If someone is critical of you, it's because they're angry. They're inconsistent. You're not the one with the problem. No. How could that possibly be? Not me. There's just so much wrong with what he just said. First of all, he is now responding to criticism, which he said many times before in this sermon, you shouldn't respond to it. He told us to respond carefully. I don't think he was very careful here because the Apostle Paul spoke a great deal of criticism to the Corinthian church. Paul, he was just angry. He was just dealing with some inconsistencies in his life. The Bereans who criticized Paul, just angry, inconsistent people. The Bible calls them noble, but the Bible can be very critical. The Bible is an angry, inconsistent book. And lastly, the thing wrong with his statement, I think the most egregious thing, Greg could have used Jesus as an example here, who is the only one in history who was criticized unjustly. But instead, he's choosing to use himself. I'd rather hear about Jesus. But hey, I guess that's a critical spirit. I guess I want to hear about Jesus because I'm angry and inconsistent.
And the same would be true for you. You see it, and it's obvious to you, but it's not obvious to the person who is there. I just think the same, but I've never ever met a well-adjusted, happy, productive, and positive person who constantly bangs out hateful comments on Facebook. Is that too real? I mean, can we go there? That type of ongoing anger is not born out of a mean-spirited person. It's born out of a wound. It's born out of a hurt. I had a counselor tell me one time that behind every anger is a hurt. So we try to remember that. So when someone's shooting at us, when someone's hypercritical, when our mom just won't let up, when our dad's just all up, when our spouse is when you recognize, instead of feeling defensive, I want to have compassion. I want to try to love through the wound instead of always taking it personally. How do we respond when people are incredibly critical? Well, sometimes we don't respond. Sometimes we respond carefully.
Occasionally, you listen and you make a change.
Occasionally. Once in a while, the critics are right, I guess. Only occasionally, though.
You recognize that there's actually something that you can love from a harsh critic who points out truth, or from a loving, constructive critic that really has your best interests at heart.
Occasionally. It's really rare. It happens sometimes, but it's kind of the mutated example.
Can I get up into your business for a minute? Sometimes the people who are being hard on you are right because you won't listen. Listen, if everyone tells you you have a problem, chances are pretty good you have a problem. If your wife, who loves you, tells you you're always yelling at the kids too much, or rather, perhaps you're yelling at the kids too much. If every one of your friends, your mom and your dad, your professor, and all your sorority sisters tell you that you're dating the devil, maybe you need to cast that demon out and wait for a man of God to show up and quit settling for something beneath yourself.
If everybody tells you something, then maybe you have something to learn. In fact, Proverbs 15 says this. Proverbs 15 says, if you listen to constructive criticism, you will be at home among the wise. If you don't, if you always reject discipline, you only harm yourself.
But this only happens occasionally, right, Greg?
There are people that love you. Even I've learned a lot from critics who hate me that have actually
pointed out stuff about me that was ungodly or needed to change or simply ineffective or inappropriate. You can learn from anybody if you have a true heart to receive. I remember when I was dating Amy, I was a young preacher, and she wanted to give me a suggestion, but she didn't want to hurt me. She said, Craig, whenever you're preaching, she's just so nervous. She's like, there's this thing that you do, and it's like, and it makes it hard to hear. She said, all the time, no matter what you're doing, I hate to say this, but it just really bothers me. And there's just something that you're doing with your hands. No matter where you are, she said, I don't know how to tell you this, but we all talk about it, and we all know that you do it. And no matter, for every time, the whole time you're talking, she said, you're carrying a box. She said, it would help us so much if you just put the box down. So all I know is, I don't have a box anymore. My preaching is set free. Now, I have other things. I have prayer hands, I chop the wood, and I have the flying sea. I want you to know, I don't carry a box. But oh man, I got prayer hands, and I can chop it, and it's coming your way. You better feel it, because it's coming your way. I just totally blew all the rest of my sermon, because there's power in it.
There's so many areas of my life they're better because of constructive criticism.
Sorry, I thought he was finished talking about himself.
They're even better from people that didn't like me, that pointed some things out that helped me. Be a better dad, be a better husband, be a better pastor, be a better leader. If, in the last year, there haven't been two or three or four things that you changed because you listened to constructive criticism, guess what? You are missing opportunities for growth. But look back. Sometimes you listen to it, you internalize it, and you make a change. How do you respond to criticism? Well, sometimes you don't. Sometimes you respond carefully, not driven by emotion, but led by the Spirit. There he is. Occasionally, this is going to be hard to get to the rest of the message. Occasionally, you listen and you make a change. But number four,
you always work to guard your heart. You always work to guard your heart. Why? Because we will not be one who lives with a critical spirit.
What's a critical spirit?
Who has the critical spirit? Satan is called the accuser of the brethren.
Yeah, where is he called that, preacher? It's Revelation 12:10. He accuses them day and night before God. Satan accuses the brethren day and night before God. And do you know what God's word says, shuts his mouth? Our deaths. Seriously, that's what the text says. It doesn't really say that people who are critical are the devil. As you read through the holy book of God's word, you find a whole lot of God's people doing a whole lot of criticizing. Now, Jesus himself did a whole lot of criticizing. Is Jesus the devil, preacher?
He is the one who is the father of lies. He is the critical one who heaps shame and guilt. And we will not allow that spirit to drive us to have a critical spirit. In fact, Proverbs 12, 18 tells us this, that some people, what do they make? They make cutting remarks. But the words of the wise bring healing.
Now, this is true. Some people make cutting remarks. They, for example, call their critics Satan. Now, the Bible is described as a sword, a surgeon's scalpel that cuts and heals. It can be kind of critical, the Word of God.
I don't want my words, my heart, my spirit to be cutting, to be detracting, to be life-taking. I want my words, my heart, to spirit to be life-giving, to build others up, to encourage them on to godliness.
The cutting, critical Word of God doesn't do these things?
The problem is, because of our sinful nature, guess what? We can be the critical ones.
It's not a sin to be critical. It's really not. In fact, Scripture commands us to be critical. 1 John 4:1, Beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God. For many false prophets have gone out into the world. Philippians 1:9-10, And it is my prayer that your love may abound more and more with knowledge and all discernment, so that you may approve what is excellent, and so be pure and blameless for the day of Christ. Hebrews 5:14, But solid food is for the mature, for those who have their powers of discernment trained by constant practice to distinguish good from evil. And 1 Kings 3:9, This is the prayer of Solomon, who wrote the book of Proverbs, okay? Give your servant, therefore, an understanding mind to govern your people, that I may discern between good and evil. For who is able to govern this, your great people? 1 Thessalonians 5:21, Paul says, But test everything, hold fast what is good. Now, Matthew chapter 7, Jesus himself tells us to beware of false teachers, wolves in sheep's clothing. Now, how can we do that without being critical? I don't know. There's something about that sheep's wool. It's kind of weird looking. Hey, don't be critical, Satan.
When we talk about dealing with critical people, so often we have no idea, because critical people often don't know they're critical because they justify their own criticism, because in their ignorance, they actually think they're right to tear things down.
Are you criticizing critical people, Greg? Critical people are ignorant? That cuts me, Greg. That cuts me deep.
We have no idea how incredibly critical we can be, born out of a sinful spirit. Can you believe the way she dresses? Wearing that thing in here, acting like she loves God. Oh, all she loves is that job she got. She's trying to show it to everybody else. Can you believe the way she dresses?
I guess Paul was an ignorant Satanist, because he instructed Timothy to instruct women to dress modestly in 1 Timothy 2:9. Peter says the same thing in 1 Peter 3:3-4. Solomon says this in Proverbs 11:22. This is coming from the guy who made the YouVersion app, by the way.
I'm just being honest. I'm just saying. I'm just telling it like it is, right? We have no idea how incredibly critical our own spirits can be. We're going to guard our hearts against that.
I agree. Not all criticism is just or correct criticism. But Greg here seems to be categorizing all criticism as unjust criticism. When Satan accuses the brethren, he does so unjustly, because he accuses them before the one who imputed his righteousness to them.
I can be very critical.
I can be very opinionated, which is, sounds better, but I mean just critical, right? What about you? Here's my areas. Now I can pick apart the way you dumb people spend your money. You shouldn't spend all that. What are you thinking? You're dead. I pick people apart. In a leadership organization, I can come in and give you 15 things they should do different. Parenting, well, they shouldn't let their kids, so that's it in this place right now. On and on. Someone that doesn't have a work ethic, I pick them up one side and down the other. Give them a real job. Do a 10-hour day. See how that feels, Mr. Led by the Spirit. Free-floating thing. Why can I be critical? My critical heart is always born out of either pride, ignorance, or a hurt. That's what it is. It's pride, it's ignorance, or it's a hurt.
So what do we do? What do we do to overcome a sensitive spirit to criticism?
Repent and believe the gospel.
It eats me up. Listen, some of you, this is keeping you from doing what you're called to do, because you get so wrapped up into what they think. Or how do we overcome living with a critical spirit?
Repent and believe the gospel.
Let me tell you how we do it. We have to become deeply grounded in who we are in Christ.
Who are we in Christ?
We talked about it last week. Clarify your calling. This is who I'm called to do. Because I know, God, this is what you're calling me. This is who I'm supposed to be. I'm so confident and assured in your opinion of me, of who I am in Christ, on what I'm called to do for Christ, that criticism doesn't derail me from your... I can overlook that because I've got a higher calling.
It's back to your calling. Ain't nobody gonna stop my calling. Back off, haters. God called me to start this business. God called me to go to college. God called me to do this or do that. But what has he called us to do? Who are we in Christ? Remember, that's the point. We have to remember who we are in Christ. That's what the preacher said. Well, according to the preacher, we're the one called to go back to school. We're the one called to wear that dress to church. We're the one called to apply for that job promotion. No, the Bible says we're called to be conformed into the image of Christ, who saved us. That's who we are in him. Romans chapter 8. We are being conformed into the image of Christ. That is what he called us for. That is who we are. Miserable sinners, enemies of God, who have been bought by him, our sins paid for by his perfect life and sacrificial death on the cross. We have been given his righteousness, and we are being conformed into his image as an example to creation that God has not abandoned it. All this is covered quite thoroughly in Romans chapter 8. Romans 8 is included in the YouVersion app, so I know Greg knows it's in the Bible.
If you want to get caught in the lower things, picking it apart, I've got something that's more important to do. Therefore, since I'm already approved by God, your approval or disapproval doesn't derail me from doing what God called me to do. And at the same time,
tell me something good.
Because I know who I am in Christ.
I'm not sure you know who you are in Christ.
I don't have to tear somebody else down to justify myself or make me feel better.
Doing this doesn't really make me feel better. Well, I mean, it does. It makes me trust God more that he would take a miserable sinner like me who is prone to cast off all criticism as unjust and unfounded, even criticism that is correct and warranted, and choose instead to say they're only doing it because something's wrong with them. I'll tell you what I've discovered. When you enter into discernment ministry, you learn a whole lot about yourself, and most of it, well, all of it really, it isn't good news. The only good news is that I've been saved, redeemed by a perfect, righteous Savior.
What happens? I'm not driven by praise, and I'm not derailed by criticism.
If I need your praise to live, if I live by the presence of your praise, I will die by its absence. I can't be driven by what you think about me. So what I want to do is I want to get to the place in my life where very, very clearly I'm not motivated by praise from people, and I'm not derailed by their criticism. I won't let compliments go to my head, and I won't let criticism go to my heart. I'm just doing what God called me to do. I don't have to tear you down to make me feel better. And if you don't like what I'm doing, if I can't learn from it, I'm going to dismiss it and I'm going to rise above it because God has called me to overlook this offense.
How do you deal with critical spirit? You're assured. I'm confident. I'm going to love you. I'm not responding driven by the flesh. I'm responding driven by the Spirit of God. This is who God called me to be.
This is like the American Idol approach to criticism.
And for you to tell me that I need lessons?
Tamika, go to an audition where they lie to you. Thank you very much indeed.
Oh, no, I'm not about to go to an audition where they lie to me.
Yeah, we're telling you the truth and you don't want to hear it.
Go there. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
If you don't like me, we move on. Some of you, you need this to fulfill your calling. You're too wrapped up in what everybody else thinks. It's idolatry. You cannot please God and be living for the approval of people. When you serve God, there are going to be people that are critical. You got to deal with it.
Critical of your service to God. Critical of your allegiance to Christ. That's what Jesus told us. And he said they would be critical of us because they were critical of him. A servant is no greater than his master. And we are blessed, he said, when this happens. It is one of the ways we are being conformed into his image. But you know, it's not really about dealing with criticism for how you wear your hair, or how you sing, or whether or not you decide to be a stay-at-home mom.
You gotta, the higher you rise, the more critics you're gonna have. The more you do, the more people are not gonna like it. It's a part of it. You wanna make a difference, you gotta learn to live with it and rise above it. I'm not gonna let the praise go to my head, I'm not gonna let the criticism get in my heart.
What do we need to know? Paul said this, so powerful. Romans 14:10, Paul said this. He said, so why do you condemn another believer? Why pick him apart? Why tear him down? Why do you look down on another believer? Can you just sense the critical spirit going on that he's addressing? He says, remember, we're all going to stand before the judgment seat of God. He says, yes, each of us will give a personal account to God. So what does he say to do? Let's stop condemning each other. Let's stop tearing each other down. Let's stop picking each other apart. Let's stop being nit.
Context to a verse. Who cares? Does it work for me?
Receive one who is weak in the faith, but not to disputes over doubtful things.
Now, other translations say disputable things. Some things are disputable, or they have not been firmly established. Some things are indisputable. Paul is very clear on this. The gospel, indisputable. The person and nature of Christ, the sovereignty of God, the infallibility of Scripture, these are all indisputable. But Paul says there are some disputable things, and that's what he's talking about. Now, Paul doesn't say that we shouldn't talk about these disputable things. We shouldn't argue over them, or argue in the sense of debate, or discuss them. But that we should not cast someone out simply because they disagree with you on one of these things that are disputable. What kind of things are disputable? Well, when we read the chapter, Paul puts it into context.
For one believes, he may eat all things, but he who is weak eats only vegetables. Let not him who eats despise him who does not eat, and let not him who does not eat judge him who eats, for God has received him. Who are you to judge another's servant? To his own master he stands or falls. Indeed, he will be made to stand, for God is able to make him stand.
Food. What people eat. See, there were some who were saying, if you eat pork, you're not a Christian, you see. Paul says not to do this. But it is permissible to talk about it, as Paul is doing here in this letter.
One person esteems one day above another, another esteems every day alike. Let each be fully convinced in his own mind. He who observes the day, observes it to the Lord. And he who does not observe the day, to the Lord, he does not observe it.
Holidays, that's a disputable matter. You know, I've got Christian brothers and sisters who believe that if a person, for instance, lets their kids trick-or-treat on Halloween, they aren't really Christians. Now, Paul says not to do that. Now, we can discuss the matter all day long as a family, as brothers and sisters, about whether or not we should celebrate Halloween. But we should not say that one party is not part of the fellowship for disagreeing with us on this matter. Now, if one party believes that the great pumpkin is God and we earn our salvation by waiting for him in the most virtuous pumpkin patch in the world, yeah, then we can say, I'm not sure this person is part of the fellowship of Christ.
He who eats, eats to the Lord, for he gives God thanks. And he who does not eat, to the Lord he does not eat, and gives God thanks. For none of us lives to himself, and no one dies to himself. For if we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. Therefore, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and rose and lived again.
Now, Paul is talking about some indisputable things, the gospel. If someone believes that Christ did not live, die, and rise again to this end, it might be time to break fellowship. But not over food, not over this holiday or that one.
That he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. But why do you judge your brother? Or why do you show contempt for your brother? For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall confess to God. So then each of us shall give account of himself to God. Therefore, let us not judge one another anymore, but rather resolve this, not to put a stumbling block or a cause to fall in our brother's way.
Now, in the context, he's talking about judging in the sense that you are judging whether or not this person is a believer. That term stumbling block he uses often in his criticism of the Jewish believers, including Peter. You know, Paul criticized Peter to his face for this, by the way, Galatians 2, 11 through 13. Paul uses this term stumbling block a lot, in that these Jewish believers were laying stumbling blocks in the way of Gentiles by insisting that they obey the dietary laws of the Jews before they could be admitted into fellowship. They were also insisting that they be circumcised. That is a perverted gospel. Paul states this clearly in the book of Galatians. We are not to do that. He's not saying not to judge anyone for anything, because if he were saying that, he would be contradicting himself and what he wrote in the other texts we mentioned.
I know and am convinced by the Lord Jesus that there is nothing unclean of itself. But to him who considers anything to be unclean, to him it is unclean. Yet if your brother is grieved because of your food, you are no longer walking in love.
Now, this is interesting because it does kind of address the issue of personal calling. But note, it is a calling to sacrifice. I'm called to give up meat because God has called me to give it up so as not to personally be an offense to others. It's like a personal self-denial. Not because it's a universal command, but because it's personal for you. This is something God wants you to give up for a specific purpose. And it's about denial. It's like giving something up, sacrifice. Now, this chapter has helped me a lot in a personal matter for myself. I grew up a Southern Baptist in East Tennessee, where it was preached that it's a sin to drink alcohol. Then I moved to New York and found all these devout, Bible-believing Christians who indulged in the occasional alcoholic beverage. It caused me to reconsider what I had been taught, and so I searched the scriptures, and I'm now convinced that it is not a sin to drink. Now, it's clearly a sin to be drunk, but not to drink alcohol. Now, Paul even mentions wine here in this chapter in verse 21, and the context demands that we interpret that as an alcoholic wine. Now, there's no way around interpreting that way. That's the context. So I don't believe it's a sin to drink alcohol, but I am convinced it is a sin for me to drink alcohol. Why? Because I'm an alcoholic, or I should say I am prone to alcoholism. There's no doubt in my mind that it is a sin for me to drink any form of alcohol, but that's not to say that it's a sin for others to drink it. Now, on the other side of the coin, I smoke cigars. There, I admit it. And I'm challenged many times, even criticized for it, and I have brothers and sisters who open the scriptures and try to make a biblical case against smoking cigars to me. And you know, I don't go, la 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 la, I'm called to smoke cigars. I listen, I engage, I respond. And at the end of the day, it is the Holy Spirit that convicts us on these matters. That's what Paul is saying. And I have to admit, I have been feeling some conviction over it. But that is not to say that you should be feeling conviction this way or that way. This is what Paul means in Romans 14 when he says, we are not God. The Holy Spirit works in us individually on these matters, these disputable matters. And he often uses the wise counsel and, yes, criticism of our brethren in the faith. So I'm going to try to give up cigars. Even though I cannot say with certainty that everyone should give up cigars. I'm beginning to believe that I should not be smoking cigars, so I would ask that y'all pray for me. It's a very stressful time, both corporately in the world and with what's going on personally in my life. Not the best time to try to quit, but I'm going to give it a shot. Anyway, back to the sermon.
Picky about every little thing. We're not called to be anyone else's judge. We're called to love people. There is enough negativity in this world. There's enough hatred. There's enough angry people. I don't want to be a voice of discouragement. I want to be a voice of life. I don't want to be one who's looking for something that is wrong. I want to be one who's looking for something that's right. If you want to look for something to be critical about, you can find it anywhere and everywhere. But if you want to look for good, if you want to see God working, if you want to see people growing, you can see it, and you become what you focus focus on. If you focus on the negative, you will become negative spirit, and you will never be used in a big way by God when your first response is to criticize everything you see. Because God did not look at the world and say, this is bad. He looked at the world and he said, this is good. What I created is good. And when it went bad, then what did he do? He sent good, pure, holy, and righteous, his son Jesus, to redeem what is bad and to bring what was dead back to life, because that's what the people of God do.
He also flooded the earth, killing everyone except Noah and his family. He saved them in an ark. Now, he sent his son, the perfect ark, to the earth to rescue all those who would believe in him. But the very presence of this ark condemned those who would not believe in him, just as the presence of Noah's ark condemned those who would not believe that the flood was coming. This is what he himself said in John 3:18, not quite as popular as John 3:16. This is a kind of truncated gospel Greg is presenting here. I mean, sure, this is what God did, but are we to always do what God does? I mean, we're not God. Wasn't that Paul's point when he was criticizing the Roman church in Romans 14?
When we walk into the room, light walks into the room, because Jesus is the light and he dwells within us.
Now, what does light do? John 3, verse 19. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light, for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light, so that it may be seen plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God. So light, it would seem, is very critical of darkness.
Wherever there is darkness, the light shines into the darkness. When a Jesus follower walks into the room, what we do is we lift spirits.
That's not what Jesus said in John 3:19 through 21.
I'm looking right at it.
We encourage one another. We build each other up in the faith. We point people to Jesus. We love, we encourage. We'll tell the truth, but when we tell the truth, we always do it in love. If somebody has something to say to us and they're critical, if we can learn from it, we do, and we change, and we recognize we haven't arrived. We let iron sharpen iron.
This only happens occasionally, though, remember?
But if it's just a distraction, a voice from the dark side, we have a higher calling, and because we're called higher, we rise above it, and we overlook the offense because God is calling us, and we are not living for the approval of people because we already have the approval of God. Step into it.
It's this kind of vague notion of a calling again. That's what he's resting his whole argument on, this generic, nondescript doctrine of calling. But it's not really generic, vague, or nondescript in Scripture, though. It's outlined in detail in Romans chapter 8. If you have the YouVersion app and you type in Romans chapter 8, it will come up and you can read it.
This is who you are in Christ, and that frees you. That frees you to love people like Jesus loved. All of our churches, let's pray together. Father, thank you so much.
Now, am I critical? Of course. So are you. Everyone is critical. You have to be. We make critical judgments all day long. Every decision you make is a critical judgment. You chose to click on this video instead of a different one. That is a critical judgment. Is it possible to be too critical? Well, yes, in some things, but not in all things. You know, when they're going over the airplane before it takes off, does anyone accuse them of being too critical? No, we want them to be as critical as humanly possible. Now, am I too critical in some things? Of course, it's my nature, but I try to fight that, and I have the Holy Spirit helping me to fight that. Sometimes I'll find myself watching one of these videos and I'll think something, but then I'll think, you know, you're being too critical. You're judging this person, not what this person is saying. See, that's what we try to concentrate on, what a person says. And that's how communication works. When you communicate, you're being critical. A statement is made, you hear it, and then you respond according to your judgment of it, your criticism of it. So we're all critical. Now, how do I handle criticism? Well, by the Holy Spirit. He helps me. I get a lot of it doing this, and some of it is downright nasty. A lot of it has nothing to do with what I said, but with who I am. I've gotten called names. I've had some terrible things said about me, but I never respond in kind. And that has nothing to do with me. It's all the Holy Spirit, because my nature is, when attacked, to attack back in the same manner. If I'm bitten, I'll bite back. If I'm cut, I'll cut back. But by the Spirit of Christ, I'm able to do something different. He says something different. He says when you're struck on the left cheek, turn to them your right. It's all His doing. Believe me, you wouldn't want to see Donnie without the Spirit of Christ. He's no good. But I'm being made more like Jesus. I'm being made more like Him. I'm not making myself like Him. He is making me like Him. And who would have ever thought that? This crude, ill-tempered, selfish, critical, redneck of an East Tennessee hillbilly. Jesus said, I'll make that one like me. Such is His grace. Such is His mercy. Y'all take care, and I'll talk to you again soon.